If you watched my Ghostbusters review, you might recall that I started it out by dropping some truth bombs, so it seems only fitting that I drop another one for the Ghostbusters edition of Movie Math, and that is that this new reboot with an all-female cast did not really work out, which is a shame because it continues to exist in this weird middle space where people like it, some people like it, but some people hate it so much that in a similar situation to Batman v Superman, that hate is able to keep a number of people from even trying the movie in the first place. And unfortunately, Sony was able to deliver good reviews, although the haters, I think, were able to discredit those to some degree as well because they skewed so strongly with female critics supporting the movie, which is very interesting in and of itself. Sony wasn't able to deliver a box office headline that could cause the people who decided to pass on Ghostbusters its opening weekend to maybe reconsider seeing it. Now, of course, there's the group that are trying to kill it, and they definitely weren't going to go. But, you know, again, you're trying to win the hearts and minds, or at least the wallets, of that middle group. And they just simply didn't show up. Now, it's really weird and even more sad by the fact that there was a window, a small window, where it seemed that maybe Ghostbusters would be the first movie to beat the naysayers, right? To beat this new trend of certain factions of fandom being able to kill a movie, really, to actually make sure that it's DOA. I wouldn't call Ghostbusters DOA. There's still a sliver of hope, but it doesn't look good. But anyway, for a while there, when I got that pretty strong Rotten Tomatoes score, and then some of the industry insiders started predicting that it would open at $50 million or more, it seemed pretty good. And if it had opened with $50 million or more, that would have been all the difference. And it must really kill Sony, Feige, and his cast that they were only a couple million away from that game-changing number. But since they were under 50, they only debuted in second place. A 50-plus number would have put them in the number one position, and they couldn't meet the projections that had gone out at the last minute. See, I talked earlier about Suicide Squad's box office predictions of 125, and how sometimes predictions can be good because they get people more into seeing your movie because they're like, oh, everyone's going to go. Look at that prediction. I should go too. But then sometimes if that prediction isn't met, you end up not looking good, even though, you know, 46 million is very high for everyone involved. It's the biggest debut ever for Feige and McCarthy. Sony likes to point out that, oh, this is the biggest live-action comedy debut since Pitch Perfect 2. Well, Pitch Perfect 2, first of all, cost like half the amount of money to make, like less than half, actually, and it opened much bigger with close to $70 million. So while it might be the biggest since Pitch Perfect 2, it's not close enough to really say it's the same thing. And actually, when they made that comparison, I was like, maybe Paul Feig wasn't the right person to do this. Maybe they should have hired someone like Elizabeth Banks, who was directing for like a moment there, but then I guess decided against it. But anyway, she's turned down a couple of gigs and has decided to focus on her acting career and her family, which says a little bit something not so great about female directors, but I digress. But what I wanted to also point out before we get into some other aspects about Ghostbusters is that, you know, I think that the hate situation is pretty bad. Again, touching on that with Marvel versus DC fans in today's morning movie news. But, you know, I don't think a lot of people don't realize what they might potentially be killing indirectly by killing Ghostbusters, the all-female Ghostbusters, right? Like, I know a number of you are very supportive of the idea of an Idris Elba James Bond movie. But Sony, who, by the way, is the same studio, they would be nuts to do that after this reaction. Because while it won't be the same group, it might be some of the same group, actually, you're going to have the same kind of response, potentially, from a group of people who just honestly don't feel that James Bond should be black. And just like they felt that, you know, Ghostbusters shouldn't be women. And so well organized and so effective and so unrelenting. You know, unfortunately, Sony gave the haters a lot of ammunition with Ghostbusters. But, you know, maybe who's to say there wouldn't be some ammunition in an Idris Elba Bond? But when something like this happens, I think it's going to make everyone in Hollywood to be like, take a step back and be like, yikes, I don't think I want, you know, maybe I want want to do something like a new character, like with, you know, Star Wars. Star Wars is really flying the diversity banner all by itself these days. But, you know, you'd be like, I'm not going to take a trusted brand where I have hundreds of millions, if not billions of dollars at stake, and risk it by trying to change it up. It's just not something that I'm going to do. And maybe in today's environment, post-Ghostbusters, J.J. Abrams wouldn't have been able to do what he did with Star Wars. But luckily, his movie came before. But honestly, Sony in particular, I mean, the Bond franchise, I think it could jump to another studio, but right now it's still at Sony, and they're certainly not going to experiment with that whatsoever. Now, did people dislike Ghostbusters? Not the people who saw it, which makes it even more sad. Audiences, for the most part, really enjoyed it. It got a B-plus cinema score overall. It was an A-minus from anyone under 25, and then males and over 25 gave it a B. I think the real difference there, and I gave it a B as well. I said, like, as a woman, I gave it a B-plus, A-minus, you know, as a female fan, liking that it existed. But, you know, bottom line, truth bomb, it's a B movie. And I think that, you know, again, also what divides that group is who's seen the original Ghostbusters and who hasn't. If you haven't seen the original Ghostbusters, maybe it's a better film. But if you know what's doable, you're like, it's a B. So that settled down to a B-plus cinema score, though. And while, you know, the multiple on that could be pretty good, you can take the cinema score number and kind of get an idea of the legs of the film. You know, not having a China release date and opening at number 2 and not being able to meet the 50 million mark, it just doesn't have a good taste anymore. You know, Ghostbusters doesn't seem like a winner, and perception is really, really important. I mean, will they make a... Well, before we get to the sequel thing, I do want to touch on the female movie critic situation for just a moment, being a female movie critic myself. And I think that, you know, as a lot of publications pointed out, female movie critics were more supportive of this movie. Not in lying or misrepresenting it, but willing to point out, you know, it's not as good as the original Ghostbusters, but it's a fun movie that has some good elements to it. And, you know, because of the way Rotten Tomatoes works, that figures to being a positive review. And I think that was very interesting because Meryl Streep, when she recently talked about how necessary it is to have female movie critics, she said it's because, you know, they're going to pay more attention to female-centric films, they're going to support them, et cetera, et cetera. And you're like, wow, Meryl Streep was right. So I thought that was a very interesting development. But, you know, the female movie critics, you know, couldn't convince enough people to give the film a shot, which is very, very unfortunate. So will there be a sequel? I think that with no China release date, all those elements, I think it's very, very unlikely. But I think that what could potentially save it is if for some reason this movie does really well on streaming. You know, like if there's a sudden curiosity factor, or once the cloud of hate is passed, right? And people are like, oh, well, Ghostbusters, it's right in front of me. Should I stream it? You know, I'll hide my screen on the plane so nobody knows what I'm watching and doesn't give me a problem. Or I'll watch it, you know, in the comfort of my own home. Will more people give it a chance and realize that it's fine? Well, it's better than fine. It's a good, it's a solid start. Could it have been a better start? For sure. But I think that it's very easily fixable, as I talked about in my video talking about potential ideas for a sequel to Ghostbusters. I think it's very easy to be fixed if people are willing to give it a second chance. But anyway, so that's the Ghostbusters situation. So sad. So sad. But then, Brian, I wouldn't say this isn't why we can't have nice things, but I think it's why we can't share nice things and pass them around to other groups besides white males. You know, Central Intelligence had a similar little bit of a problem out of the gate. There wasn't any hate for it, but, you know, white audiences weren't really willing to try it at first, but they certainly seem to have discovered it because, again, when we look at the top 10, you're going to see Central Intelligence is the lowest drop of the top 10. So very impressive. Couldn't happen to a nicer or better movie. But as for the other new releases this weekend, Bryan Cranston, The Infiltrator, opened at number 8. It didn't have a lot of theaters, but it was still a wide release and should have done better than that, especially because the competition is so poor at the bottom half of the top 10. He has some more commercial films coming up. I mean, like, this will do better than Trumbo, but, you know, like, nobody saw Trumbo, which is too bad because Trumbo is a great freaking movie. And it got him an Oscar nomination, so that's good. But his box office numbers have become so toxic that he really has to post some good ones. And he's trying with two mainstream films, Why Him, the James Franco movie that he has coming up, which is kind of like Meet the Parents. And then also he's going to be in the Power Rangers movie. But I don't know. I think the Why Him movie isn't going to hit, and Power Rangers could hit, but his role is not particularly large, and I don't know if that would be attributed to him at all. We'll see. But Woody Allen, boy, look at that per theater average. Now that's what a per theater average for a limited hot release is supposed to look like. And Cafe Society easily captured the best per theater average of the year. So its awards campaign is off to a very good start. Now, as for the rest of the top 10, animation continues to be incredibly strong. It's really basically right now superhero movies and animated movies. That's what makes all the money in Hollywood and gets most of the attention. The Secret Life of Pets stayed at number one. It fell just 51%, which is a better hold than Minions last year, which fell 57% in its second weekend. Finding Dory is now not only the biggest grossing film of the year domestically, but domestically also the highest grossing animated film of all time. Isn't that amazing? It's not even that good. I mean, even those of you who liked it, I mean, honestly, does it deserve to be the highest grossing animated film of all time domestically? No. And then also Ice Age Collision Course, which comes to our shores this coming weekend, is doing very well overseas on opposite shores. So it's already off to a good start. And interestingly, overseas box office is why that franchise is still alive. Then Tarzan, Warner Brothers should be very pleased, breathe a sigh of relief as it swings past 100 million in just 3 weeks and 200 million worldwide. That's pretty darn good. Again, it has to get around 400, 500 million to even break even. But I think that's a pretty solid showing. And I think that if I were Warner Brothers, I'd maybe take a second crack at that movie and bring its budget way down to around 100 million. Again, Central Intelligence, lowest drop in the top 10. So that's a nice little note to finish on. As for this coming weekend, Star Trek Beyond is expected to be the number one movie, and it's supposed to open around 50 million in the 50 million range. Let's see if it can do it where Ghostbusters could not. However, even if it does land there, the first two Star Trek movies in this new timeline opened in the 70s. They also opened in May, so maybe this release date just isn't working for them. But, you know, Marvel's called that release date for quite some time. But anyway, Star Trek Beyond, it'll be nice if it owns its weekend, but it's coming in about 15 million below where it should. 20 to 15. Ice Age Collision Course will be next with 37. We'll see. It's going to fight with Secret Life of Pets for your animation dollars and Finding Dory. Very crowded with the animation field. And then Lights Out, a horror movie's going to come on the scene. 12 million. That's solid. It's a very cheap movie. James Wan just prints scary blood money right now, right? So anyway, that's this week's Movie Math. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for joining me. Please write down below your own thoughts on the box office for this weekend, and you can check out some other episodes right now.